Welcome to Organolysis. So this is our rearrangement reaction part 4, and in this video we are going to talk about Beckmann rearrangement, which is very much important. And a small part of this related to this Beckmann rearrangement is a Beckmann fragmentation. We will also discuss both of this topic, and Beckmann fragmentation is a small part, so we will discuss it later. At first we are going to talk about the Beckmann rearrangement. So see the compound which is very much involving to this Beckmann rearrangement, and the reagents and what kind of product it is formed. And in the reaction, the name is the rearrangement. So there is a kind of rearrangement has been takes place. So you have to know that. So at see first the compound which is very much involved for this reaction, like this type of compound. There is X is attached with this nitrogen, and X may be varied by using your OH or OTS or OMS or CL, like that. Okay, so you have, if you don't have any leaving group, then you can't undergo can't do this rearrangement reaction. Okay, so see the reagent is a protonic acid or any kind of Lewis acid. This basically any kind of that H2SO4, that is your protonic acid, or any Lewis acid like BF3. Okay, so that's it. Now see that I have written the two different kind of structure of this. That is, you have to know important steps for this reaction is the anti-migration. See, here I am taking the compound that this X and R2 are seen to each other, and this R1 group is anti to its to this group, and here is the R2 is anti to this. By changing this part, we are getting to different kind of product, and that is how we are getting and this kind of amide, that is R1 is here and R1 is here. So why this kind of reaction takes place? So see the mechanism. At first we have to know this that this Beckmann rearrangement undergoes the anti-elimination. So at first, that is, you have to know the anti-migration. Okay, so this is your anti-migration. Now let's see the reagent we are going to use. That first, it is the protonic acid, that is your H plus or any kind of H2SO4. So if you use this H plus, this oxygen lone pair takes a proton from this, and it will prepare this OH2 plus, and then the rearrangement takes place. That rearrangement is called the 1-2 shift. So there is a 1-2 shift spin takes place, that is your 1-2 shift. Now this group will migrate to here, and this will leave from the system, just because it is now a leaving group, good leaving group. So that is why this anti-migration takes place. And I also discuss that why this anti-migration is selectively takes place, not this, why not this R group is selectively takes place. Okay, so that is why due to this anti-migration, this reaction is very much stereospecific. Okay, so that is why this is highly stereospecific. So this is very important. Now this, if this R group is migrate to this nitrogen center, then this R prime is attached to this nitrogen part, and here you have the positive charge. Now here I am written this resonating structure of it, that is this one. Here you are getting this kind of product. So if now you have the water in the medium, so this oxygen lone pair attack to here, and you are getting this kind of, and after this tautomerization you are getting this kind of amide. Okay, so this is your, if this X is replaced by OH, so that is your keto oxime. So it is your keto oxime, and this NOH double bond, NOH bond is called oxime part. Okay, so see the another kind of mechanism. Now if you use a PCl5, so the reagent basically used for this reaction, so here I am written over here the reagents, what kind of reagents are used. That is, we also discuss some different kind of reagents, and now I am short to written over here, that is your H2SO4, PCl5 and SOCl2, BF3 or PPA, that is polyphosphoric acid, or that is H3PO4. Okay, and the another is a PHSO2Cl, like that. This kind of reagents are basically used for this reaction. Now see that if you use the PCl5, now what will be the mechanism? Now we can write this PCl5 in this way, PCl4 and one Cl here. Now this lone pair attack to this phosphorus center, and this Cl will leave. Now you are getting this kind of OPCl4 derivative. Now after that, this R bond, R prime group will migrate to here, that is just because of this anti to each other, and it will leave from the system. So we are getting OPCl4, that is minus, and this kind of intermediate. Okay, so this is our intermediate. Now this water lone pair will attack to the center, you are getting this kind of amide. So the product is basically the same, but you have to prepare a different kind of two different types of reagent. Then mechanism is all same. In if you use this protonic acid or any Lewis acid, the mechanism is same, but the pathway is slightly different. Okay, so see, now I am already said that this is your anti-migration. Now why it is anti-migration? So there is basically you can prove by using kind of reagents, but I also show you the MO diagram or MO approach, that is how you can easily understood that why this anti-migration takes place. Now we are taking that this N and this OH. Now this nitrogen center has a sigma star orbital. I am written over here, that is your sigma star orbital, and here you have the R group and R prime. So R group has a filled sigma orbital, so it has a sigma orbital of it. Now this will migrate to here. Now there is a phase matching. This is your sigma orbital. Okay, so this is your sigma and this is your sigma star. So this is anti, that means it is 180 degree to each other. So that is why the phase matching is also has been present, and the degrees, that is 180 degrees, also facile for this reaction, and that is how you can get this anti-migration, not this in migration. Okay, so this is your anti, and that is the reason behind it. Okay, so this sigma to sigma star, and there is a phase matching of it. Okay, so you can show it like this. If this is in dark one, then it also has in dark one. Okay, so that is how you can easily say that this is anti-migration. Now let's see the now it is a one kind of proof that you can use if you use the different kind of reagent, not different reagent, that is the different isomer of it, then you get a different kind of product, and that is this reaction proves that it is very much highly stereo specific and as well as the anti-migration. Now see, I am taking a compound, that is this one. This compound is 2-bromo-5-nitro benzophenoxime. Okay, so that is 2-bromo-5-nitro benzophenoxime. Okay, so this is the compound. Now we are taking this this methyl and this NOH group are anti to each other. So we all know that anti-migration takes place. So if this methyl is anti, then if we use H2SO4, this is OH2 plus, and this methyl will migrate here, and you are getting this product. Now if we use the same compound by using a NaOH in cold medium, then this OH, this, that is your O minus, and it will attack over here, and this will, bromine will leave. Now we are getting this 5-membered ring. So just because of this OH and Br is seen to each other, and this methyl is NOH anti to each other. So that is why this reaction possible. But when this methyl and OH are seen to each other, now then this overall R group, I am written this overall R like that. If you consider this overall group is R, then this group will migrate to here just because of it is now anti to this nitrogen site, and that is how you get this kind of product. But when you use this NaOH, the same reaction condition, that is NaOH, then this will negatively charge, but it will not attack to this bromine just because of it is not same side to this group. So it proves that this reaction is highly stereospecific, and as well as the anti-migration is takes place, not the seen migration. Okay, so this is the one kind of proof of this reaction. Now let's see the some examples which are important for your exams. That is, here I'm taking the phenol, and if we use the H2Ni, that is a one kind of reducing agent. I already made a video on a different kind of reducing agents, so you can go over here and check those videos. So I already discussed this H2Ni also. So this H2Ni reduces this benzene ring, the aromatic part of this ring. So you will getting this cyclohexanol. And if you use this copper, that is your oxidizing agent, one kind of oxidizing agent. So this CHOH group is selectively oxidized to getting this C double bond, that is your cyclohexanone. Now here we use this NH2OH, that is, if we use this NH2OH, this is nothing but this one, and after this water, after this leaving of water, you are getting this kind of oxygen. So this is your oxime. Now your substrate is ready to undergo this Beckmann rearrangement. Now if you use this H2SO4, you are getting this kind of product. So that is which bond. Now question is which bond will migrate. I will show you that this I have already written over here that N and OH is here like this. Now which bond is anti, either this or this. So this bond is migrating just because this is anti. So this is not your anti, so you are getting this kind of product. Now this is called epsilon caprolactam. So this is your epsilon caprolactam, and it is very much important in case of polymerization reaction. Okay, so if you use base in this compound, you are getting this kind of open ring structure, not open ring structure, that is your open structure. So that is how you get this product, and this is called nylon 6, and so this is basically used for polymerization reaction. Okay, so this epsilon caprolactam is very much important for polymerization reaction. Now let's see some more example that I'm written over here. That is, this is your R group, R, that is because of it is a chiral center, and it is R. So this R isomer, and if you use this H2SO4 and water, this group will migrate just because it is anti to this OH, and you are getting this product. Now this reaction implies that this R group will not change its stereochemistry, so that is retention of configuration. So retention of configuration. Okay, so this is retention of configuration. That is why this reaction is that is how you can prove that your reaction is intramolecular, not the intermolecular. So it proves that this reaction is intramolecular. Okay, so this is intramolecular. Now see the one more example, and with the use of this pH2Cl. So this is nothing but we can write this pH2Cl like this. Lone pair attack to the sulfur, Cl will leave. You are getting this kind of intermediate, and after this methyl migration, you are leave from the system, and after the hydrolysis, that is your H2O, you are getting this kind of product. So now the one more thing that you have to important for this reaction, that is the migratory aptitude of this migratory aptitude of group is not important. That is important is that the which one is anti to this auxin group. Okay, so that is important. Not the if the migratory aptitude of this ring, migratory aptitudes of two groups, now it is not your important, and that is not your purpose. Your purpose is to check that which one group will anti to this auxin part. Okay, now let's see the next example, that is a trifluoroacetic anhydride. So the same thing is happening over here. This will attack over here, and this is O minus. Now you are getting this kind of intermediate, so it will back over here, and this will leave, and after that this group will migrate and it will leave from the system. So the basically the reagents can be varied, but the mechanism is not varied. The mechanism is similar for all the cases. Okay, now let's see one more and last example of this Beckmann rearrangement is that this, if you use this NH2OH, that is if you use NH2OH, then you have to prepare by using NH2OH, you can prepare this auxin. So now we are getting the auxin. Now if you use this P2O5, so this is our Beckmann rearrangement step. Now you are getting this product just because of this will migrate to here, just because it is anti to this OH. Now you are getting this intermediate. After this tautomerization of it, that is double bond over here, here is the OH, and this bond will attack here, it will leave from the system, and you are getting, after this leaving of water, you are getting this isoquinoline derivative. Okay, so that is how you can cyclize this from here to here. Okay, you can prepare by this way. So okay, so that is how the Beckmann rearrangement is important for different types of cases. Now see the last and final part is the Beckmann fragmentation, and why this fragmentation takes place and how this fragmentation takes place. Now see, now here I am taking the compound. Now you have to know when the fragmentation will happening. Now fragmentation will happen in that cases when the R group has a tendency to form a cation. Okay, and stable carbocation, not the cation, that is the stable carbocation. Okay, here you have the group that is tertiary group, that is a 3 degree part. This 3 degree alkyl, the tertiary alkyl group, If you have the H plus in the medium, it will protonate it first. Like this, you have OH2 plus. Now this bond can go here and this will leave, and you are getting this tertiary, a 3 degree carbocation. So the things you have to mind when the fragmentation will occur and when the rearrangement will take place, that is how we can easily predict by checking this R group. Okay, whether this, if this R group is much more bulkier, and if the R group has a possibility to form a stable carbocation, then it will follow the Beckmann fragmentation pathway. So now this part will form a 3 degree carbocation, and this MeCN triple bond N will form during this reaction. Now here we have the one more group. Now we are taking this two compound in a mixture, as a mixture, that, and to prove that, that is that it is a proof that how we can understand that the fragmentation is takes place. Just because you are taking into consideration the two compound, that is this one and this one, in a mixture. Okay, so this is our mixture part. Now in presence of water, this OH2 will leave and it will form a stable, it will form a carbocation like that. Now you are getting this two part. Now the important thing is that, now if we mark it, that is your R2, here is your R1, now here you have the R2 and here you have the R1, like this, like that. Okay, now this nitrogen has a lone pair of electron. Now it can attack either here, just because it is in the mixture. Now it can attack over here or here. Now this nitrogen lone pair also a possibility to attack either here or here. So there is a 3 to 4 different kinds of pathway. Okay, so like this, that is either them written over here, that is your A path, this is your A path, or this is your B path and this is your B path. Okay, so that is how you can get the 4 different kinds of products. Okay, so like what kind of product that you get, that is either this kind of product after the hydrolysis, that is your NH C double bond O R2, like that. After the hydrolysis, I am written the product after this hydrolysis, that is the here have the water will attack over here. Okay, now this kind of product. Now if this CN nitrogen lone pair will attack over here, then what kind of product that you get, that is pH this NH C double bond O R2, like this. This is one kind of product, or there is a, this is your path followed, this is a path B product. Okay, so this is your path B, and if it is follow the path A, then pH NH C double bond O R1, or this 3 degree group NH CO R1. Okay, so this is your 4 product. So this reaction, this overall reaction proof that there is a possibility of formation of the fragmentation reaction. So that is called the Beckmann fragmentation. So that is the importance of this fragmentation and the rearrangement reaction. And I hope this video is very much helpful for you. And if you have any doubt, you can ask me in comment section. And that's it for this video. And thank you so much for watching.